Okay, so this is blood from one of our study subjects, centrifuges. This is kind of PCR row. This is what we call our $100,000 toaster.
So do you have any flu virus here?
Yeah. And I warned you that this wouldn't be very impressive, but that's a tube, a small tube of influenza.
We're here at the Wilson Lab at the University of Chicago. Researchers here work on influenza. One of the projects they're working on is the search for a universal flu vaccine.
And so the goal would be to have a vaccine that you would get one shot and you'd be protected against all influenza for the rest of your life.
The search for a universal flu vaccine is really heating up. What they're working on here is one of many projects underway. I wanted to find out how close we are to getting a universal flu vaccine and why we really need one.
Flu is unique. It defies all the paradigms you have about, for example, measles. You either get infected with measles or you get properly vaccinated with measles, and you're done. You're good to go. You're not going to get measles again. Influenza changes. It continually changes.
These continuous changes are why seasonal flu vaccines are not as effective as we want them to be.
So is the inherent problem with influenza, or the inherent challenge with influenza, that the virus itself is always changing?
Yes, but it's not that simple. We have to redesign the seasonal vaccine every year. And so there's an elaborate process by which all the data from the laboratories around the world is assembled by the World Health Organization and then the CDC with the FDA to look at the viruses out there to say, based on what's out there, what should be the formula for this year's vaccine? But bigger than that is this problem of the ability of what's referred to as shift.
There's so many influenza variants that are in many different animal species, and the capacity for segment shifts or antigenic shift to combine the genomes of human influenzas with zoonotic strain influenzas could make viruses to which there's very little immunity.
And if that virus is created, and that virus has the ability to infect and to be transmissible, that's the spark that's going to trigger a pandemic. It's that part of it that really scares people.
About 100 years ago, we had the Spanish flu. So that was a pandemic that infected a fifth of the world's population and killed somewhere between 50 and 100 million people. And that's just nuts. It's easy to assume that something like the Spanish flu couldn't happen today because now we have modern medicine. But actually, the people I spoke with said that we're more vulnerable now than ever.
Many more people, much more density, much more international travel. Should a pandemic virus emerge that has that kind of potential to spread and has that degree of severity, the world would be in trouble.
And when I spoke with Martin Friede at the World Health Organization, he told me that because of a risk of a pandemic, one of the greatest benefits of this type of vaccine would be in low-income countries.
This is Martin.
According to Dr. Friede, if a pandemic were to start today, it would take about 6 months for the first dose of a vaccine to become available, and about 18 months for a steady supply to be available in middle and low-income countries.
Now, this is where the universal vaccine has its first and greatest potential impact. Countries that don't want to use it on an annual basis because economically they don't see it, they would at least have access to a vaccine that can be made and stockpiled.
Everybody I spoke to for this story talked about the risk of a pandemic. And what they all say is that it's not if, it's when. And how do we know there will be a pandemic? You said it's a matter of time.
The virus is perpetually mutating. It mutates all the time. The virus grows in birds, it grows in pigs, it grows even in bats and in horses. And there's more and more of us human beings, and we're living in closer and closer proximity to these animals. And this, it's a numbers game. So it will happen.
Researchers around the world are working together to develop a vaccine that would prevent a pandemic. One of the approaches is structure-based design. So let's take a look at the structure of the influenza virus. It has these proteins on its surface, and one that's been interesting for researchers is called hemagglutinin.
If you picture it metaphorically, it looks like almost like a mushroom or a broccoli with a head and a stalk. The part that's the head is the one that induces the dominant immune response. That's the good news.
The problem is the head is also the part of the virus that tends to change a lot. And so now what researchers are becoming more interested in is the stalk, or the stem.
And the stem part of the hemagglutinin molecule doesn't change much at all from season to season or from strain to strain.
The fact that the stem is conserved is important. If you designed a vaccine that induced a response against the stem, that vaccine might be effective against multiple strains of influenza, even when the virus mutated over time. Anthony Fauci's team is conducting a phase 1 trial of a vaccine candidate that uses a stem-based approach. In that candidate, they've put lab-grown stems on a self-assembling nanoparticle.
If you look at the hemagglutinin molecule and you look at the body's response, the head is much more immunodominant. So if you wanted to make a response against the stem, but you showed it to the body associated with the head, the immune system would get distracted a bit and would make a really good immune response against the head and maybe a little bit against the stem. But if you really want to get it against the stem, you remove the distraction of the head and you put the stem in a way that the immune system sees it very, very clearly. And when you put it on a nanoparticle, the immune system sees it very, very clearly.
But that's only one of the approaches that's currently being investigated.
So there's actually a lot of space still in the vaccine, in the influenza vaccine field. So there is the stock-based approach, which is in clinical trials now, has been in two clinical trials, but there are additional approaches to target things like the receptor binding domain, neuraminidase, and several other epitopes on the viral hemagglutinin or neuraminidase protein that in combination would make a multi-pronged vaccine approach that we hope could be more effective.
So how close are we to a universal flu vaccine? Well, that pie in the sky version, that perfect version, that's probably a good ways off. But everybody I spoke to said that we'll get there in a stepwise fashion with incremental changes. That incrementally better vaccine could be just a few years off. There's so much more to this story that we couldn't fit into the video. I hope you check out the article I wrote about the universal flu vaccine. You can find it on JAMA.com.